Guys, grab hold of a Bible and make your way to the book of 1 John this morning. Sunday mornings, that's where we are. We're working verse by verse through the book of 1 John. And so really, we pick up this morning where we left off last week, and so excited to be able to do that. We hope you got a Bible. I'm hoping you opened up to 1 John chapter 4. If you didn't bring one, there are Bibles in front of you, in the chairs in front of you, page number on the screen. You can get there rapidly. If you want to use an electronic device and follow along in an app, you can do that as well. Either way, one way or another, we long that you would have the Word of God before you so that today God would speak to you through His Word. If you're joining us online or you're in the overflow, please hear the same invitation. Have the Word of God. Have it so that this morning what you would hear would be what God would say and His Word would work good into your life. That's what you need. That's what I need. And so we long that you would have that before you as today we want to dive into what God has. Well, before we do that, let's take one more moment and pray and admit our need. Let's just ask God to help us. Let's just ask that He would open up our hearts to hear from Him, to hear what He would have us to understand this morning. And I'm going to lead in that, but I'm hoping you are praying as well. Father, right now we step into this space and I thank You for Your Word. I think it's good. I think it's powerful. I thank You that You work through Your Word to shape us. That You do at work that nothing else really can, just transforming us on the inside. Do that today. Help us to understand. Help us to get it, but more than that, help it to work inside of us. Lord, would You take that part of what we talk about this morning that is specific for each person here? And it will be different. I know that. I know that's how it works. And I love that You can do that. But You're the only one. So God, in Your power, would You work today so that Your Word is done, accomplished in us, Your work is done by Your power, by Your Spirit. For each one of us, I ask, but for me as well, just help us to hear from You. We ask it together in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Five words. Five words can literally change your life. Five words that would be just something that could transform how you face your day. That's what I want to hold out to you. Five words. Perfect love casts out fear. Perfect love casts out fear. Yeah, this is what God tells us. That's 1 John 4:18. That's what He declares to us. And it is one of these incredible realities that could change the way that you're walking through your life. Well, that's what we want to look at this morning. And so those are found in two verses that we're covering this morning. 1 John chapter 4. Let's look at that. Hope you got a Bible. Follow along. Read it with me as we note that which God tells us. Verse 17. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as He is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love. But perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. Perfect love casts out fear. Yeah, that's what's found here, and that's where it's meeting us. That's what God would want to speak into our lives, and it's what we need to dive into. So let's begin with the idea of fear. You recognize fear. It's not one of those uncommon terms. The Greek word is phobos, which we get our word phobia from, you know, kind of like you have a phobia. It's fear. It's one of those words that probably even finds itself even weakly within things that you might speak. That said, it might be helpful to just pause and give a very clear definition of what this is. What is fear? What is fear very specifically? Even this Greek word that is used for fear. Fear is an emotion experienced in anticipation of some specific pain or danger, usually accompanied by a desire to flee or fight. It's a pretty clear definition. Honestly, it is. It's an emotion that is coming because you anticipate something, because you're thinking about something that's coming. You're thinking about something that is either painful physically, emotionally, or dangerous. And that place not only finds you afraid, but often right there when that fear comes, there's a desire to either fight or flee. Doesn't mean you always do it, but it's there. And that just that, oh, just that fear that rises and creates space. Wow. Fear. Yeah, you understand it. It's a part of our world. In fact, I think about it this way. If you're reading with us through the Bible, you know that today you were reading in Psalm 11, and I like it. I like what David talks about. In verse 1, he simply says it this way. How can you say to my soul, flee as a bird to your mountain? What did you just say? It's a great thing, because I understand, if you can track this with me, probably you've said this. He feels it. He feels something happening in our world. He says it's almost as if a voice is just speaking, run away. Run away to a mountain. Like, take words like a bird and run. You just need to get away. Run from where this is. Run from what this looks like. That you look at the world and just say, hey, I want to go. And I don't know what that sounds like to you. I don't know if you're like, you know, take me to a deserted desert island. Or maybe you're like, no, right in the middle of Alaska, like right out there, a cabin where nobody can find me. And now I don't have to hear anything. I mean, it's that kind of feeling. It's like, how could you tell me? I just run. What is happening here? What's David experiencing? Well, he says, for look, the wicked bend their bow. They make ready their arrow on the string, that they may shoot secretly at the upright in heart. If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? David looks out at his world and he says, it just feels like the wicked are winning. And it feels like they have the bow notched, and they're seeking their arrows, they're preparing destruction, they're seeking to bring harm, and it seems like it's happening. Like things that are evil seem to be succeeding, and it troubles him. On top of that, things that should be firm, things that should be sure, strong foundations. He says it feels like they're crumbling. It feels like they're crumbling. And these realities have him in a space of saying, I just want to run away. Like there's a voice that's saying, fly, like flee, get away from this. And I just say this because, again, I know that for somebody here this morning, you're like, that's it. Like that's, okay, fear. I mean, fear of what's happening in our world, fear of where this is going. I get that. And I tie into that this morning because, again, it's a very real thing. Fear. It's a part of our lives. That said, let's just begin and also understand fear can come in lots of shapes and sizes, right? We can be afraid of different things. We can, you know, they give it titles so often with the word phobia. Like you'd have hydrophobia, which is kind of like the fear of water. You know, you take different fears, and for some of you, you'll grab it with me, and you might even be able to think of that Charlie Brown part, you know, right, from the Christmas special. Anybody kind of know what I'm talking about? Where Charlie Brown's there, and she's sitting with Lucy, and Lucy's like, hey, if we could just label your fears, like that could help. And she begins listing all these fears, and then she just looks over and says, you know, maybe you have pandaphobia. And he's like, well, what's that? He's like, pandaphobia, fear of everything. And he's like, yeah, that's it. You know, like, I'm afraid of everything. When God speaks it here this morning, please understand, that's not exactly what he's addressing. Like if you're afraid, like you're like deathly afraid of spiders, I can't promise that this verse is going to fix that. It might help. It actually might help, but it's not really what it's aiming at. We're not just talking about that kind of, you know, like, okay, I'm afraid of something. It's a very specific fear that is just identified and addressed in our verse. So notice how it says it. Let's just kind of follow it along there. Verse 17. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness, notice, in the day of judgment. In the day of judgment. And then scan down to verse 18. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear, the fear that we're talking about, involves torment. Yeah, we're not just talking about fear, like fear of spiders. We're talking about a fear that is a fear of judgment. That is a fear of facing judgment, a fear that really moves into this place that he says it's there because it involves torment. It involves torment. Now, this is important. Now, here's the thing. When I say that, for somebody here this morning, you're like, well, that's not a problem for me. Like, I don't even think about that. Like, I mean, that's not something that, you know, is normal in my life. But I want to tell you, that's probably not true. I like the way it gives it to us in the book of Hebrews that tells us Jesus came, and as he came to be our sacrifice, he came to release us, release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. He says, here's what he's doing. He's doing something that there are, that in our sin, all of our lifetime, our whole lifetime, there's this bondage and this fear of death and fear of judgment. You might not always identify it. You might not always say, well, yeah, that's what it is, but I'm telling you, it's there. I would even say it's built into you. I like the way it gives it to us in the book of Ecclesiastes when it says that he, God, has put eternity in their hearts. That he's built us for this so that there's a reality that almost echoes inside of us. Now hear me clearly. God's word is very clear. There is a judgment coming. It is appointed unto man once to die, says in Hebrews, then the judgment. That's clear. Everybody dies, and there is a judgment that follows this. If you're in Christ, you will not stand before God the Father. You will stand before Jesus, but that's a different judgment. It's a reward. It's a different thing for another day. If you don't know Jesus, you will stand before God the Father, and you will be judged, and that will lead you to torment. That's clear. I mean, that's exactly what God's word tells us is coming. But somehow I think you know that. It's an interesting thing. God has built that almost prepackaged into our heart. Like, you have to work hard to convince people otherwise. I mean, it's almost just natural. Our world does this. There's so many lies in our world that work against this reality. But it's an interesting thing to understand that tells us in Hebrews that all of our lifetime there's this bondage. All of our lifetimes there's this fear of death. And it really does grip lives. It really does grip our lives in such a way that I want you just to identify as best as you can that it's incredibly powerful. That it's incredibly powerful. Even in ways that you might not fully perceive. It moves things in our world where so many within our world, they live their lives afraid to die. Afraid to die. Because there is a sense they know. They know that's coming. And it grips them. I think about these last couple of years, walking through COVID and definitely not, you know, talking politically or any of those things. I'll just say it this way. For many, it just ramped that up in incredible ways. That in many ways, fear became very motivating. Fear becomes much bigger than that, though. It happens so much in lives that people find themselves living that really almost behind this fountain of youth mentality, behind this idea that wishes that we could solve all this, there's this fear. There is this fear of death that grips our lives, that grips what's there, and it is powerful in ways that maybe you understand, maybe you don't, but that's what we're talking about. That's the fear that God is wanting to tell us can be dealt with and can be dealt with well and can be dealt with in your life. That's the fear where he's going to tell us perfect love can cast that out, can cast out that fear. That is what we need, and that's what we get to talk about. So fear we understand. Let's talk about perfect love for a moment. Again, I want you to notice that he mentions it twice in our text, so I just want to make sure you see it again. Verse 17, he says it this way, love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. So perfect love. Love has been perfected in us. Perfect love casts out fear. This is good news, but let's just pause and make sure that you understand what we're talking about. We are not talking about your love. We're talking about God's love. The love that's being identified here is his love towards us. And this is great because if it was saying, hey, if you just have perfect love, you'll be doing good, you would probably maybe rightly say, well, I'm out. And like that's, I don't do anything perfectly. I mean, I do everything imperfectly, and that's probably true. And if this held us to something like we had to do it perfectly, we would look on it and say, I hope somebody gets there. It's not going to be me. But it's not that. The love that's being identified is God's love. And because it is God's love, it exists. It exists presently. It is a love that is fully in him because this is who he is. Now, that's what we've been talking about. That's been a big part of our section, right? Some of you will remember. Go back one verse with me to verse 16 of chapter 4. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. And he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. Pick it up in our verse 17. Love has been perfected among us in this. God's love here is this thing that is present. It is fully who he is. He is a God who, by his nature, is this. It's not something we're hoping he does. We're not something we're waiting for him to do. It is a thing that he's inviting you to see that he is and he's accomplished. In fact, it puts it there in verse 17 in the verb form where it talks about perfected, and it is a verb that is a passive verb. It's a verb that describes that. Now, many of you guys know that. I mean, you kind of remember this is like basic English, and some of you, or you did really well in it. Other, you're like, I don't do English. Like, no. Like, diagramming sentences was what terrified me. But understand this. There's a power in understanding this. There's a very big difference between an active verb and a passive verb. An active verb means you're doing the work. A passive verb means the work is done to you. An active verb is the boy hit the ball. Passive verb is the ball hit the boy. You're not doing it. It's happening to you. You're not the one who's accomplishing it. It's being done to you. It's being just received into this moment. And this makes this incredibly good because we're talking about God's perfect love that he says it is present. And again, you can just see it there at the beginning of verse 17. Love has been, not is, not is going to. It is, has been perfected among us. This is something that we are invited to recognize. This is something that, yes, we're needing to see it, see where it is, see what it is, but in that sense, to allow it to be that meets us. Now, very, very clearly, the love that's being fully on display, the love that's being spoken, is the love that God had for us in sending his son. Again, that's where we've been, but I want to make sure you see it. Go back to verse 9 for a moment. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, or made clear to us, or shown to us, that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. In this is love. Not that we loved God. It's not about you. It's not about what we're doing. But that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Wow. This is good news. This sets it in the realm of hope for us this morning. Because again, if I had to say this is you needing to do something perfectly, again, you could leave here and say, good for somebody. You know? But if I'm telling you, know that I'm inviting you to see God. I'm inviting you to see Christ. I'm inviting you to see the love of God. I'm inviting you to know that there's not anybody in this room that's outside of. Now, maybe you're not his. Maybe you're outside of this. But I can tell you, God so loved the world, he sent his Son. And that love is being put toward you to invite you into this relationship with Jesus. And if you're his this morning, this is yours. This is yours. It's not something we're waiting to have happen. It's already there. It's already present. It's already a part of our lives. And so we are invited in to see what it is. Okay, that said, I need to add a little quick thing here because I need to be accurate. I need to make sure that I'm saying it exactly according to the text. And if the way I do this may or may not be helpful, God help it to be helpful right now. Yes, this is passive. Yes, this is God's love, but it is meant to be active in and on and through us because that's already what he said. He used this word perfect, this idea of perfect love, just a couple verses before this in verse 12. So go back to it and notice it with me. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. Wow. So that's where we were last week, but I take a moment just to remind you. He's inviting us into a place of receiving God's love, but that love would become transformative in us and flow out of us. I think about how Jesus said it in John 7. If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Wow. This is a really good space to just think this through. Jesus says, are you thirsty? Are you thirsty? Do you find your soul in need? Do you find yourself parched and thinking, God, I need life. I need the water of life. I need the source of life. Jesus says, come. Come to me. I'm it. I'm the one that brings the water of life. I'm the one that can satisfy. I am the one, Jesus says, who would fill that emptiness in your life, which he is. He says, if you drink from me, not only will you be satisfied, but out of your heart will flow rivers of living water. That God's love is not something that is just, you know, received that doesn't change. It does something inside of us, which is really important in the book of 1 John. Because in this section, in fact, we'll see, get to it in our next section as well, part of it, he's calling us to love people, telling us that that's absolutely essential, that if God's love is in us, it is not an optional part of the Christian life, it is part of it. But it's worth just saying it again. It's God's love that does it. The only way that you can have the love that God wants to have is to have his love inside you, permeating and pushing through. And so that's what he's telling us. He's telling us that this is the love that would work there. This is the love that would bring us into that. That this is the love that would be that that rescues us from fear. The perfect love that can cast out fear is this love received, this love flowing through you. Or maybe even better articulated. Notice what he says there in our text. Go back to it. We've read it a couple times, but we want to highlight it. We'll just read verse 17. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment because. Pause there and catch that. Because. That's always important. He says, here's how we have this. I mean, this is what this is. This is everything we're talking about. What's the because? Because as he is, so are we in the world. Yeah, is he is. This is because of Christ. This is because of our connection to Christ. This is because of being in this relationship to Christ. Christ is the very access, which is what we just read there in verses 9 and 10. This is the love. This is what God is. It's this having relationship in Jesus, and because we're connected to Jesus, that how he is, we are. Because he's overcome the world, we will overcome the world. Because he has conquered death, in our connection to Christ, we conquer death. Because he is the one that has life. In him, we have life. It's him. I mean, it's this whole in Christ. It's this picture of even how it said it in verse 16. You can go back up there and see it again. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. And he who abides in love abides in God. And God in him. It is this beautiful picture of connection. It is this beautiful picture of being in Christ, which is one of the most simple and profound realities that describes the Christian life. I like the way Paul would say it in 1 Corinthians. He says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. If you've become one that is in Christ, that's changed everything. This changed everything. I mean, that literally is everything. And if you're a follower of Jesus here this morning, he says, that's you. You've this radical thing has happened because you are in Christ. You've been born again. But it's important that I just say, not everybody here probably is in that category. And I don't say that to be unkind. I'm saying it to be very, very kind. I'm telling you, hey, if this is not you here this morning, if you're not in Christ, then this doesn't work for you. If you're not in Christ, I can't rescue you from fear. In fact, I will go as far as to say is you should be afraid. Because there is a judgment, and there is torment for you, and that should be there. It doesn't rescue you from that. That's where you're heading. But if you're in Christ, you can be rescued from that. If you have this relationship with him, it does that. I love that. It's this powerful reality of seeing that it's Christ. It's because of our relationship. It's that connection we have to him. Paul would say it to the church in Colossae in chapter 1. There he says, to them, God willed to make known what are the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. It's us in Christ, Christ in us, abiding in him, him in us. It's this beautiful connection to him. In fact, Romans 8 would say it this way. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And you just want to notice those in Christ Jesus. We'll come back to Romans 8 in a moment, but it's worth him just saying, hey, this is who you are. If you're in Christ, then there's no condemnation. If you're in Christ, judgment's been taken care of. Torment's been taken care of. And it's because of being in Christ. It's because of who he is. This is the reality that's there. And if that's who you are, that's where you stand. That's where you stand. But the part of this verse is saying, you just need to believe it. That if you're his and you're in Christ, it might be, again, that fear still grips you, but it's not because you should be afraid any longer. If you're in Christ, it's gone. Perfect love, he tells us, can cast out that fear. Perfect love, grabbing it, seeing it, understanding it, knowing it, it does this thing. It takes this thing that is fear, and it casts it out. I like the word cast out. It's worth just understanding. It has the idea of forcing it out. Literally, it would have the idea of expelling it. And it's this way of understanding that this fear of death, this fear of torment, this fear of judgment, and the love of God, they cannot exist together in the same space, that they can't be in the same space. So if you get a hold of the love of God, the fear is gone. The fear is pushed out. This is, again, just track with me for a moment, because if you're missing this, he's not asking you to make fear your focus. He's not asking you to look at fear and kind of like, you know, stare into it in the mirror, you know, and chew it out. Like, fear, you go away. Like, no, I'm not going to do that any longer. I mean, it's just like that would actually work. I mean, instead he says, you know, but if you know God's love, it just goes. I mean, if you grab hold of what the love of God in Christ is, the fear moves away. It is cast out because love does it. It's God's love embraced, God's love understood, that drives out that fear. And that's what I'm holding out to you. Perfect love can cast out fear. Now, as you grab that, it might even be worth just pausing for a second and understanding that is not how God wants us to live. God's intention for you is not to live a life of fear. Now, I suppose I should be technical just for a moment and make sure we say it correctly, because somebody would say, but Jim, doesn't God tell us, you know, the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom? Yes, and that's a good thing, but that's a different fear. If you take all the weight of Scripture and you look at it, the fear of God isn't a, you know, place where we're afraid of torment or we're stressed. It's ultimately reverence. It's ultimately a place where it's like, God exists. There's a God, and I live my life under the reality of God. That's the fear of God. But the idea of being terrified, of living in this emotion of fear that grips us and causes us to want to fight or to flee, that is not how God wants you to live your life. In fact, it's an interesting thing. Many of you guys know this. You know, we have that phrase repeated over and over throughout Scripture where God says, do not fear or don't be afraid. In fact, some have gone through and counted and said, hey, there's 365 of those references in Scripture, which is always kind of an interesting thing. There's a give or take, and if you wanted to argue, you could do that, but it's at least close to that. And if it is 365, it's an interesting thing just to think it through for a moment and say, huh, there's 365 days in a year. I mean, I wonder if God kind of, you know, planned that, you know, kind of a thing to say, you know, almost like from a daily standpoint, this is not how I want you to live your life. This is not what I have for you. In fact, I like the way he says it in Timothy. It says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. So this is not what God's giving you. He doesn't want you living terrored. He doesn't want you living in fear. Instead, he wants to give you power and love and a sound mind. That's what Christ is seeking to work into us. He's not creating a relationship that is in a space where fear is that which motivates, grips us, draws us. That's not the way Christ works. That's not the way this works. God doesn't want us to have that. In fact, he gives us a very different perspective. He says instead of being afraid, it would give us boldness. Well, that's the word he uses, but just so you see it again in the text in verse 17, love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Because as he is, so are we in the world. He says we could have boldness. What is that? What's he talking about? Well, it's not arrogance. I mean, sometimes we can think about boldness and think, is that being arrogant? No, it's not arrogance. It's freedom. It's freedom that's what we'll have on that day of judgment. But it's meant to be today. It's meant to be today where there is a sense where as we think about death and as we think about what happens after death, instead of being afraid, we have confidence. Instead of being terrified, we have confidence. Now, I found myself thinking about this. There's a passage in Hebrews that tells us that if we could grab what we are in Christ even now, we would have boldness to come before his throne. He says we get to come boldly before the throne of grace, that we could find mercy and grace to help in time of need. And it's this beautiful picture of what the access we have to God is even today in prayer. And the way that should work is if you're in Christ, we have an access to God that is free, that is welcomed. Maybe it'd help to think about it this way. Imagine with me that you go home to your parents' home, or you maybe imagining that, or somebody else's home where in one sense you just are fully welcome. And if you are, there's a boldness to that. There's a boldness that you don't kind of wait to knock on the door or ring the doorbell. You just walk in, you know, and you don't walk in with this thought, like, I think they might kick me out. I mean, now some of you, yes, but that's a different story. But You know, but there is this, if it's right, it's like, this is, I have access. I get to go right home. I can walk right in. And he says, that's how I want you to feel about death. That's how I want you to feel about, it's not that place where you're like, oh, I wonder what it's going to be like. And I'm a little bit, it's like, no, I'm going home. I mean, this is where I'm going. I get to walk in. I have a freedom. I have a confidence. And that's true if you're in Christ, but he wants that to be the reality now. So that as you face this, it's meant to be how you face it. It's meant to be how it works. So let's think about it this way. I like it, it's how it's described here, but I like how it talks about it in Romans chapter 8. So would you keep a finger or a mark or your bulletin here in 1 John chapter 4 and go with me over to the book of Romans and go with me to chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. I didn't put a page number on there if you have a church Bible. Sorry about that, but you can hopefully make your way there. If you have to even go to a table of contents to get there, that's great. Romans 8 is an incredible chapter with a lot happening in the midst of it. We're not going to read the whole chapter. We don't have time, nor quickly unpack all of it. But in essence, what we're talking about this morning is what Romans 8 is offering us, what it's telling us we have in Christ. And I want you just to kind of move quickly through some of the main subjects in Romans 8 so you can feel it. And then maybe again later, you might want to go back and read the whole chapter. So it begins with a verse that we already quoted. Romans chapter 8, verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. A description of a true Christian. He says, now, like this is who we are. If we're his, there's no condemnation. Like there's that's never going to happen. That judgment, it's never going to be ours because of who we are in Christ. And it goes through in the next few verses and talks about the way that that is, the difference between a real and not a real follower of Jesus, and even the power that would be there. But scan on down to verse 15. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors. I'm sorry, actually, I'll start reading verse 12. Excuse me. Verse 15. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. He says, if you've got this, if God is at work in your life, he did not give you a spirit of fear. Like that is not the relationship he's created for you. He has created a relationship where you get to know God as Father. You get to call him Abba. Where the work of the Spirit is happening in there. That it's not fear that he has created. That's not the relationship that he works in you. Go on down to verse 18. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Okay, quick pause. This is important because it's right here where sometimes we get just off base. I mean, sometimes we have this idea, if God loves me, he would not let me go through anything bad. I mean, if God loves me, I mean, why would I ever go through trials? But that's exactly what this world is for lots of reasons that we won't even fully unpack right now. But it's worth just noting the Christian life is not exempt from it. It's not exempt from physical, financial, you know, relational. Troubles happen in our world because of sin and brokenness, and we're not exempt from that. But as we face that, he says, here's what we do. He says, I consider that the sufferings of this present time, they are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. He says, when I see what's coming, it is nothing. Everything down here is, I mean, these are small things in comparison. I recognize the glory that's mine. I recognize that judgment isn't mine. Instead, I'm going to have this enjoyment into heaven. And he goes through and continues to talk about it in the next verse is how that all of creation has been brought into that, that everything is waiting for that day that we enter into that liberty. And then go down to verse 28. Another familiar verse, in fact, one that many of you guys know well. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. Simply put, Christians. This doesn't work if you're not a Christian. But if you are a Christian, guess what? Yeah, this world can still be problems, but he works through everything. There's not anything that he wastes in your life. Everything, he turns it for good. So that everything, I mean, every trouble, every trial, instead of it becoming an exception to the love and power of God, the love and power of God transform everything in our life. So that everything that we go through, everything that he's doing, he is going to work good through it. Verse 31. And what should we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him freely give us all things? I mean, if he's given us Christ, if that's there, then what could ever stand against us? What could ever be that thing that would make God's love invalid or make us be removed from this? In fact, he goes on and says it more in verse 35. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long, and we are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Verse 37. Yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Like, it doesn't really matter. We overcome all of that in Christ. The love of God conquers all of that. That the love of God, you know, is just far greater than anything that would come against us. And so he goes on in verse 38 and says it this way, for I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers nor things present nor things to come, nor height nor depth nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's what 1 John is telling us. This is what 1 John is telling us. He says, if you get this, if you can understand the love of God that is in Christ and where we are, there's just nothing else that could ever get in the way of that. Nothing could rob that. David would say it this way when he thought about it. He says, in God I put my trust. I will not be afraid. What could man do to me? It's a good question. If it's God that we're in, who could ever mess that up? Nobody. Nobody. This would be an amazing confidence that would change the way you face trials and troubles in our life. One of my favorite stories of early Christianity is John Chrysostom, who was kind of preaching Christ, and he got arrested for it, and they were trying their best to stop him from continuing to preach Christ, and so they just began to tell him, hey, you know, John, you're going to have to stop preaching Jesus. You know, we're just telling him. He's like, no, I'm not going to stop. And he's like, okay, if you don't stop preaching Jesus, we're going to fine you, and we will take away everything you have. We will take away, you know, we'll take away all your accounts, we'll take away all your money, we'll take away your house, we'll take away all the stuff you have. And his response to it, and this is kind of like me saying it in my words instead of his, but his response to it in essence was, I was going to lose those things anyway, and my real treasure is in heaven, you can't touch them. So he was like, go for it. You know, it's like, you know, I wasn't taking that stuff with me to heaven, and my real treasures are there, and you can't do it. And they're like, okay, fine. If you don't stop, John, then we are going to lock you up in prison. And we'll cut you off from all people. Like, you'll never be able to tell anybody else about Jesus. I mean, you'll just be isolated. And he's like, oh, that's a bummer. Really bummer. But you can't really cut me off. You can't cut off my relationship with God. I have access to him all the time, and there's nothing you can do that would ever hinder that, and I would be able to continue in prayer. And like, fine. Well, then we'll beat you, and we'll hurt you. And he's like, well, you know, all of my sufferings here are earning for me glory in heaven. So, like, you're actually giving me eternal treasure, you know, if you kind of do that. I'm like, fine, we're just going to kill you. And he's like, then I get to go and be in heaven. You know, he's like, and their frustration was, how do we don't have anything to get this man on. I mean, everything we are saying we'll take away from you. He's like, well, I was going to lose a lot of that anyway, and my real treasure is in heaven. You can't touch it. You can't touch what I really am. And I want to tell you that's what he's offering for us here. He's telling us that there's a space that we would be able to say, hey, nothing can separate me from Christ. I am more than a conqueror. Everything he's working together for good. Heaven is going to be far better. And I mean, the love of God, it just catches me, holds me, keeps me, and draws me into a solid space. That's what he's offering to us right here. Maybe it would help to come at it and say it another way. If you have this, death and what happens from death, it really becomes defeated. It becomes a shadow. You know, it tells us in 1 Corinthians that Christ, because he died for us, he took the sting of death for us. He took the what death was, the sin, the punishment, he took all of it so that death is no longer able to hurt us. It's no longer able to wound. It's gone. In fact, I like the way we sang it just a moment ago, right? We were singing Psalm 23. Right before the sermon, and in that well-known psalm, it talks about God being our shepherd. And there in verse 4, it says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. It's a great psalm. And when he talks about the valley of the shadow of death, certainly he's talking more than just about death. He's talking about fear of death, the place where death feels imminent. And there's a lot of interesting pictures in that. But for us, it also certainly pictures death. In fact, it does so really well, at least for me. Because what I want to tell you is if you're a follower of Jesus and you know him, then you're just facing the shadow of death. Death itself has been defeated. And if it works well for you like it does for me, I have a silly brain, just going to admit that, I have like this cartoon thing that happens inside there. Would you rather be hit by a truck or a shadow of a truck? It's a big difference, right? I mean, you get hit by a truck, that's like, wow, that's crushing, devastating. The shadow of a truck, it might scare you. Like if a truck just wheezes by and the shadow runs over you, but it's like, whew, that's a shadow. That's a shoo, shoo. Yeah, that's great. Can I just tell you, death for you is a shadow. It's what it is. It's not going to defeat you. It's not going to crush you. That if you're a follower of Jesus, it's coming. It is coming. You're going to die. Now, again, I know somebody's going to be like, Jim, isn't the rapture possible? Yes. I hope it happens. I hope we're alive for the rapture. But can I tell you, it is 6-1, half dozen of the other, because in a moment, you're going to be gone. That's the idea. And you know what? If it doesn't happen then, it's going to happen some other space. There's a day coming that you're going to die. And I don't know how you feel about that. The honest thing is that for some of you, because you haven't processed through what we're talking about this morning, you're scared. You're scared. You're scared to die. Now, you might say, Jim, I'm not scared to die. I'm just scared of the process. I get that. I kind of understand that. But honestly, that's not really true. Most of us don't live every day like, okay, I think if I eat this food, I might die. If I, we kind of know like it's going to happen and it's going to be a little shocking. But here's the deal. If you know Jesus, the moment you take your last breath here, you're in God's presence. To be absent from the body is to be present with him. It's just going to be a shadow. It's going to be like a truck passing by, and the shadow passes, and you'll be like, ooh, and then you're there. And then you'll be like, this isn't so bad. Jesus, he made a way. I'm in God's presence. There's no more judgment. There's no more condemnation. I have life. And so what he's wanting you and I to do is to say, that's how you're supposed to be thinking about this. That you and I are supposed to be facing that day where we're not actually afraid of it. We're not actually scared to die. We're like, well, get to be with Jesus. I mean, if I get to stay, I get to serve Jesus, that's really, really good. But you know what? I'm not afraid of it. I'm not afraid of it because he has done this. He has defeated it. This idea of saying it, that he has made a way where that is no longer a part of I am, that this idea, again, of perfect love, it casts that out of fear. This incredible space where if you have this, there's a place where that won't be where you are any longer. So with this, he gives us one other thought that kind of ties this down or makes it even more present. So I just want to read it. If you're still there in Romans 8, like I am, you can flip back over to 1 John 4. Let's read one more time the verses we're covering here. It says in verse 17, love has been perfected among us in this, that we might have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. He who fears. He really almost asks this a question right now. You know, this place where almost just saying, are you this? So I just want you to imagine this with me just for a moment. Let's just imagine you and I are sitting down, maybe having a cup of coffee. And I'm asking, do you know Jesus? Do you have a relationship with him? And if you don't, I would love to help you get there. And even now I'm telling you that. But if you do, you say, yeah, Jim, I'm born again. I have a real relationship. Really, really good. And then I ask you, so do you know that God is love? I mean, do you believe that God is love? Do you believe that he loved you? And you might answer, well, Jim, yeah, that's like Sunday school stuff. Jesus loves me. This I know. For the Bible tells, I know that God is love. But then if I asked you, but are you afraid? Are you afraid of dying? Are you afraid of life? Here's the thing. You might honestly answer yes. And what John just simply says, if you answer yes to that, then you're not made perfect in love. This isn't meant to be accusatory. This isn't meant to make you feel bad. It's meant to help you highlight the issue. Because see, again, for somebody here, it's as if I'm talking to you and you think you believe that God loves you, but you're afraid. You're afraid to die. You're afraid of what's coming. I mean, you know better, but you're afraid. And so John just says, if you're afraid, it's because you don't know God's perfect love. But hear it again. He's not asking you to do this. He's not asking you to create it. He's not saying, okay, here's, you know, you work hard. You're going to have to work a little harder at this. He's like, no, you just need to see it. What you desperately need is the love of God that's in Christ. What you need to see is Jesus. And he would take us back again there to verses 9 and 10, where it says, in this the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. And he's telling you, as I would tell you right now, you don't believe that enough. You can. You just need to see it more. You need to see Jesus. You need to see Jesus crucified. You need to see the love of God that changes everything. You need to comprehend what that is, because if you do that, that love would expel that fear from your life. And I want to just hold this out as an invitation, and it's a good invitation. It's a good invitation that's not asking you to fix it. It's asking you to believe, asking you to recognize who Jesus is, to recognize what's in him, so that if that's present in your life, you would be able to say, I need more of that. Maybe you really do know Jesus, but honestly, you're still afraid. Then just own it. God, I need to know your love more. I need to know you really love me. I need to really get the love of God that's in Christ. Because if I get that, fear can't exist there any longer. Fear can't have any hold on me. I mean, Romans 8 would become my, like, what could separate me from the love of Christ? Nothing, you know, like fear, no, tribulation, trial, nothing, because I'm in Christ. And that would be an entirely different way to live. And if that highlights who you are this morning, I just want to invite you into this. I just want to tell you it's possible for you. And it's possible not by your effort, but by grabbing hold of the wonder of Christ, grabbing hold of the wonder of being in him, that this idea, that these five words that could change your world, perfect love casts out fear. I just want to tell you it's possible for you. You know, we're going to close in just a moment, and we're going to sing a closing song, and we're going to sing one of those songs that we've been singing for a while, which is good to do, but it's also one of those dangerous spaces that you might say it without actually processing what we're saying. So I want to just take a moment, put a couple of the verses up on the screen. We're going to sing this song that says, when I fear, my faith will fail. When those fears could get there, it's Christ. It's Christ that will hold me fast. It's not my hold on him, it's his hold on me. It's not my love for him, it's his love for me. He will hold me fast, and you're going to sing in song in just a moment. For my Savior, he loves me so. It's God's love for me. It's grabbing hold of the love of God that gives me the ability to know that I'm held fast by him, that nothing could separate me from the love of God that's in Christ, that nothing could take me away from that nothing could rob me from that, and that would give me confidence. That's what he's holding out to you this morning. So you can close your Bibles, you can close your notebooks, whatever it is you have open, and we want to just take a few moments. And we're going to give you some time to process this and pray for it. Let me just begin this and just say very clearly, I would long that this would be true for everybody here in this room, everybody that's hearing me online, but it might not be. Again, if you're outside of Jesus, you should be afraid. You should be terrified, because it is coming. It is coming. That when we think about when he tells us there in this verse that the idea that torment is coming outside of Jesus, that is honestly your destiny. And I don't say that to be cruel or mean, but just to say that's where you are. But God so loved the world, he sent his Son to rescue you from that. And if that's you this morning that is in that space, today we're inviting you to Jesus. We're telling you, hey, cry out to him to be your Savior. There's no other rescue. There's no other way. There's no other space. And so today, if you don't know Jesus, would you, in this quiet moment we give you to pray, would you cry out to him? Then come up and talk to us afterwards. We'd love to pray with you and be a part of seeing God do that work of salvation in your life. For many, you are a follower of Jesus. And maybe when I've said all of this morning, you're kind of like, yeah, go Jim. Like, you tell him, like, this is your life. You live your life, and you're like, I Romans 8's my, like, I do that. I'm not afraid. You know, what could separate me from the love of Christ? Nothing. You know, and you live in that place that you're not really afraid. And if that's you this morning, well done. Keep going. Keep allowing God's love to just keep those fears at bay. But I'm talking to some of you here this morning. You are saved, but you're afraid. And it's embarrassing almost. It's almost embarrassing that you say, well, I think I am, you know. I mean, does that mean that I need to be afraid or need to have, no. It just means you don't really believe it yet. You don't really believe how much God loves you. You don't really believe what he has done for you in Jesus. And that's not meant to be accusatory. It's meant to be an invitation that you could look and say, okay, I need it. I need to know God loves me. I need to know the love of God is in Christ. Because if I believed that, fear would be cast out of my heart. That's what I invite you to. So we're going to give you a quiet moment. And again, if it's surrendering to Jesus, celebrating where you are, or asking him to show you his love, would you just quietly talk to him about that? Would you take a moment just between you and him, talk, and I'll do the same, and then we'll come back together and close and commit that to God in prayer and then close in worship. But right now, you talk to God. God, I begin my prayer right here, praying for those who are destined for the day of judgment. That right now they are heading there and torment is the expectation of that. God, rescue. Rescue even now. Jesus, you came into this world to save sinners. Save these. Save those who are even at this moment finding themselves outside of this. I know there's no other way. There's no other freedom. There's no other access. There's no other rescue. Save these who need you to draw them. Then, God, I pray for those that know you. I thank you for some that live this out and they find such joy in it. Strengthen them. Cause your love to continue to drive out fear in their lives. And then I bring those who are struggling. And honestly, probably many are. Different levels, different spaces where honestly fear still has a grip on them. And you're telling us how that can go away. Not by our effort, not by our achievement, not by our working at it, but by knowing your love. That your perfect love would expel that fear from our hearts. God, I pray for that. I pray that you'd help us to see it. Help us to see you, Jesus, to see the gift of who you are, the life of who you are, the love of God that has worked what we have so desperately needed. Cause us to find ourselves secure in the love of God, that nothing could separate us from you. Bring us into that freedom, that boldness that would be a gift of you this day. I pray that for each of those who know you, and I ask it right now in Jesus' name. Amen.